Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the day three of Bangalore Literature Festival. As per the change, our next session is a political powwow with the super journalist Shekhar Gupta in conversation with Arun Shourie. Author, journalist, and politician Arun Shourie has received several national and international awards, including the Padma Bhushan, the Magsaysay Award, the Dadabhai Naroji Award, the Aster Award, and the International Editor of the Year Award. He was a minister in the Government of India, 1998 to 2004. His books include Does He Know a Mother's Heart?, How Suffering Refutes Religions, Worshipping False Gods, Falling Over Backwards, An Essay Against Reservation and Judicial Populism, The World of Fatwas, or Sharia in Action, Harvesting Our Souls, and Hinduism, Essence and Consequence. Shekhar Gupta's works include the most significant investigations in contemporary journalism in the region, from Indira Gandhi's Operation Blue Star to the disastrous Indian intervention in Sri Lanka, from tracking Pakistan's politics and military to the first Afghan jihad and its effects in Kashmir. A recipient of Padma Bhushan in 2009, he was the author of Assam, A Valley Divided, and a monograph, India Redefines Its Role. Before beginning the session, we would like to wish Mr. Natwar Singh a speedy recovery. Now I request the panelists to please take over the session.
I am delighted to be at the mercy of my good friend Shekhar Gupta. It is only because of this one person that the Indian Express in the North retained its great character. And he brought to the paper an independence. He brought to it a great independence. He encouraged and brought up young reporters. He introduced on the edit pages and opposite the edit page writers who contribute today to lifting Indian public discourse. So he has been priceless, and he has made priceless contributions to India. So now that I have flattered him, I'm sure you know that he'll be kind to me.
I think I can take the rest of the session telling you of the contributions that Arun has made to Indian journalism and to my life and my career. He's my first and last referee on many issues, personal and professional. And this is a relationship now going back more than three decades. In fact, 37 years since we first met in the tiny city of Chandigarh. It was so tiny that I used to cover crime there then, my first job. And not more than five or six murders would take place in an entire year. So when a murder took place, it was a moment of celebration. Shukar hai, ek to hua, and then you waited for the next one. And Arun pulled me out of there soon enough and sent me to Northeast at a very young age, at a time when Northeast had a lot of trouble. Five insurgencies were on, oil was blockaded from Assam. Many of you were not born then, but if you look at India's sort of internal security situation, it is really from 79 to about 83, the 4 or 5 years that were really the most perilous. And then other phases came, but that really was a very bad time. And he trusted me at that age to send me to Northeast. I was 23 years and 4 months old. So you also know that he is reckless. So Arun, I think we've done a proper tit for tat now. So let's talk about the state of, if we are supposed to have a powwow, so it's a bit like we met on a flight. Except because now this is, there's an audience and I think there's live streaming, so we have to be a little bit careful. So you and I can't be fully ourselves, but almost, we can try. Did we expect to get here 1 year back?
No, I think there was a great demoralization in the country, that how have we got into a trough out of which we may not come? And that was a problem. I mean, the Indian, the psychology had changed. And the sense of possibilities which had been, which let us say Panditji had created for the country, which was there after 1971, which was there after 1977 when the emergency was ended, which Mr. Bajpayee had rekindled, or after 1991 when the reforms were there, that sense of possibilities was wrenched out of India. And we just did not know. But I tell you, I've always had one thing that Mr. Chandrasekhar used to say. He used to say, two things. He said, one thing is that when we, जिस समस्या को हम लीडर लोग नहीं उसका समाधान नहीं निकाल सकते, दैट प्रॉब्लम फॉर विच वी लीडर्स कैन नॉट फाइंड अ सॉल्यूशन, वो लोग निकाल देते हैं. द पीपल सॉल्व दैट प्रॉब्लम. एंड सेकंड ही यूज टू से कि जब लोग चपत लगाते हैं तो वो झांपड़ लगाते हैं, दैट दे विल गिव अ क्लियर वर्डिक्ट. आई डिड नॉट हैव द बोल्डनेस टू एक्सपेक्ट दैट. But if I may say so, Modi expected it. He said, nahin, nahin, bilkul hoga. So it is a change in that way, and there is certainly a change in the mood, and there is a re-change in the mood also in Delhi. But if I may repeat something, Shekhar, the change in the mood is exemplified by do-teen hafte hue ek slightly elderly person is walking early in the morning at about 5:30, 6 o'clock, and he comes to 7 Racecourse Road. And the guard said, hey, kya kar rahe ho yahan? Ye dur jao, dusri taraf jao sadak ke. He said, nahin, I have come to meet the Prime Minister of India, Dr. Manmohan Singh. He said, he's not the Prime Minister of India. Man, he doesn't live here. If you find out where he lives, go there. Toh bichara chala jata hai. Toh agle din wo phir aata hai. तो कहता है भाई अब क्या कर रहे हो? कहता भाई, I have come to meet the Prime Minister of India, Dr. Manmohan Singh. He said, he is not the Prime Minister, man. Please go and get out. Go on the other side of the road. He goes away. Third day, he again comes. Why are you here? He said, I want to meet the Prime Minister of India, Dr. Manmohan Singh. He said, I told you, man, third day, don't you understand? Don't you know? He is not the Prime Minister of India today. He said, no, sir, I know. But it feels so good to hear it every morning. So there is certainly a change in the mood in Delhi. But there is also a change in the discourse in Delhi, not in Bangalore, I find. But in Delhi, the thing is that this is the hope now resides only in Mr. Modi, and the distinction is being made in the public mind, in the public discourse in Delhi, between Mr. Modi and the government.
Frankly, almost a year back, it had become evident that UPA was going to lose, because UPA had nothing to offer. Its product was so bad. And people say very often that this was lost after Rahul Gandhi's interview with Arnab Goswami. Even if Rahul Gandhi had performed in a stellar manner, he would have still got similarly bad press. Because Rahul Gandhi had spent 10 years, or at least 5 of those 10, bad-mouthing his own government. And I'll give you a few examples from election campaign, which we saw at various points of time. We are a group of friends who travel in every election. We've also traveled once in Karnataka. In Bihar, in the state elections, when they said Rahul Gandhi will now go and have 30 rallies or 35 rallies, and people of Bihar will now see our new leader and Congress will contest by itself, Rahul Gandhi had one line that he repeated everywhere. He said, "Do Bharat ban gaye hain, ek shining, ek declining. Shining mein to Delhi mein bade bade log hain, declining mein aap sab log ho, Bihari Bihari. To ab isko badal dena hai." And then he would go on and on to say how miserable the poor had become over time, forgetting that it was his government in power in Delhi for a long time. So at one of these rallies, after the rally, some of us asked, some people as usually we do, kya sochte hai uske baare mein? So some people said something, some were a bit cagey, but you know, Bihar is the most politicized society. Everybody in Bihar is a political analyst. So one gentleman, farmer sitting on his haunches, holding a stick like this, He said in his sort of Bihari Hindi, which I can't fully replicate, but something like, "Wo kahet hain ke dui Bharat ban gawa." He says that two Indias have come into being. I said, "Aap kya kehte hain?" तो उसने कहा साहब 65 साल में से 60 साल तो आप ही का राज रहा तो दो ही भारत बना दिया 5 साल और देंगे तो तीन नहीं बना देंगे सो पीपल अंडरस्टैंड एंड व्हाट हैपेंड इन दैट इलेक्शन कांग्रेस पार्टी लॉस्ट इट्स डिपॉजिट इन 221 सीट्स आउट ऑफ 240 ऑड सीट्स 221 सीट्स लॉस्ट देयर डिपॉजिट दे वन ओनली फोर सीट्स फोर इन फैक्ट दे वर कॉल्ड द नैनो पार्टी इन बिहार बिकॉज दे कुड ऑल फिट इन टू ए नैनो But the lessons were not learned. When we again saw Rahul in UP, and there was, at one point, there was a great deal of optimism in the Congress party that UP was fed up of caste parties, and now Rahul will go, and initially got good crowds. But his message was the same. He learned no lessons. His message was, I had gone to the metro site in Delhi at night. I found a laborer. You know, Rahul uses the word bhaiya very often in his conversation. As most public school boys and girls do, they address the auto driver as bhaiya, bhaiya, yahan le chalo, bhaiya, wahan le chalo, not realizing that in the Hindi heartland, bhaiya is a pejorative. So he said, ki maine pucha, bhaiya, tum yahan kya kar rahe ho? To usne bola, main metro pe kaam kar raha hu. To metro pe kaam kyon kar rahe ho? Ke sahab, mujhe 350 rupiya roz ka milta hai, to main kaam kar raha hu. Tab, lekin aap yahan rehte kahan? Main metro site pe rehta hu, in a shanty. तो आप पैसे का क्या करते हो तो बोला साहब 100 रुपया 150 मेरा खर्चा होता है 200 रुपया मैं घर बेचता हूँ तो मैंने कहा अरे तुम घर छोड़ के आए हो कहाँ से आए हो तो उसने कहा यूपी से आया हूँ तो देखिए सारे देश में यूपी से वर्कर जाके काम कर रहे हैं 350 रुपये पर डे पर और आपकी फैमिली अलग हो जाती है लोग अलग हो जाते हैं और अभी मैं आपके लिए सबके लिए नरेगा कर दूंगा तो किसी को जाना ही नहीं पड़ेगा 100 रुपया घर में बैठे मिलेगा सो अगेन द सेम जनता पोल स्टार्टेड आफ्टर दैट And one youngster said in that village, said, look, I will give him Narega 365 days a year. I will give him 200 rupees a day if he promises to live in my village for a whole year. And everybody said, we don't want to live in this village. We want to go to a city, earn 350, spend 150 on ourselves, send 200 home so our children can go to better schools. So I think that is something that Congress party, or at least the owners, proprietors of Congress party, completely missed out. And I think they forgot that India's electorate had changed meanwhile. Their definition of poverty was very old-fashioned. And that's why I invented that word, sir, povertarian. You know, povertarianism is a very Congress philosophy that the Gandhi family and their intellectuals invented. So povertarianism means poverty is my birthright, and I shall do everything in my power to make sure that you have it. And then I will throw some freebies at you. So was this just a revolt against Manmohan Singh's weak prime ministership? Or do you think there is a larger philosophical rejection of this kind of povertarianism of 70 years?
I think both things. Because Manmohan Singh also came to exemplify this helplessness. Manmohan Singh, it's almost cruel to say anything about him, but his core competence has always been to shift blame on others. So, isi tarah Sonia Gandhi par blame kar do ya. Magar what you said, these two points, very important points. One is that this idea that the people of India will be swept by sops or promises of sops, that is not working. People of India also use the politicians now. After all, DMK gave them every sop, free televisions also. Gehlot's government gave them even free medicines also. But they were swept out. And that's a very important thing for the future to remember. You have to perform precisely on the points that Shekhar was just pointing out. They want better education. Actually, all surveys show, your own writings show, when you travel, they want English medium schools and computer education for their children. Because this is the ladder to future. Magar hum unko narega promise karte jaate. So sops don't work. That is the larger point. I think second point, Shekhar, is that Rahul Gandhi is the result of, not just the cause of, he is the result of Mrs. Indira Gandhi's politics of looking for persons of who have four qualifications. They should be weak, they should be compromised, they should be salivating for their next job, and they should be willing henchmen. These four qualifications. Now, if you go on selecting persons only of this kind, and the persons you select become the UPSC for the next round, so 30 years later, you are in the condition in which the Congress is today. There is nobody who can challenge Rahul Gandhi or Mrs. Sonia Gandhi, but there is nobody who can help them. And that is actually the condition of almost all political parties in India today. They have become, now, for instance, the discomfiture about Dr. Jayalalitha, Ms. Jayalalitha being convicted. And what will happen to the AIDMK? Wo bhi bichari yatim party hai. Mulayam Singh ji ko kuch hota hai, Prakash Singh ji Badal ko kuch hota hai, Mamata Banerjee ko kuch hota hai. Everybody has just become a party around some individuals. So that is the nemesis of that kind of politics, in which the ultimate product comes out to be Rahul Gandhi, but nobody can remove him. You know, it's like a corpse. The Congress is like a corpse. It does not now have the strength to remove the fly sitting on the nose. So every party should take a lesson from that and encourage leadership to come up.
In fact, since you talked about corpse, it reminds me of a conversation I once had with Uma Bharti when she had walked out of BJP, when she had a fight with BJP. And we were talking on the banks of Narmada and Hoshangabad. And she said, BJP to party hai nahi hai, to lash hai. So I said, par nazar to aati hai party, you can see a party. She said, wo kya party hai? Ye lash hai, it's a corpse which has now got bloated and is floating on the surface of Narmada. I'm sure she has thought many times that she shouldn't have said it when she said it, but that was a very cruel description. And sometimes you find that not just Congress, but many parties look like that, because, you know, all of us have seen dacoit movies in 60s and 70s, and I'm sure there must be local equivalents also. So if you see this history of dacoity, then there was Jaga Daku and his Giroh, or there was Daku Man Singh and his Giroh. So the leader of the Giroh, of the gang, was on a white horse in front. And then Nilu, Pilu, Samba, Tamba, you know, Kalia, Pilia, they were all on chota mota horses. So the police only had to get the leader. And once they got the leader, then the rest of the gang just disintegrated. So if you see parties like Bahujan Samaj Party, Mayawati's party, Mulayam Singh's party, Lalu's party, Mamata Banerjee's party, Jayalalitha,
TRS.
TRS, there is nothing, you know, there is, at least some of these people have children, but children fight, as you've seen with DMK now, or some have nephews, but look at Mamata Banerjee, or look at Jayalalitha. So these are not people who are building political structures, and who are not building ideologies. That is a big worrying thing, and that's why perhaps one of the worrying things about, what destroyed the Congress was that Congress forgot its ideology completely. Congress invented a new one in povertarianism. Rahul Gandhi leapfrogged backwards from his father's times to his mother's time, grandmother's times, and thought he'll find voters where his grandmother had found them, not knowing that the voters had moved on meanwhile. But that is also the fear today about the BJP, because if BJP becomes a one-person controlled party, although we know that there is the RSS and there is always a tussle in the BJP, but if BJP becomes a one-person controlled party, which BJP never was, BJP actually had a modicum of internal democracy, then what will happen? And do you see that possibility?
No, of course, I think the laws apply to everybody. You know, karma catches up. So, it can't happen that BJP will be immune from the effects of such developments. And the astuteness of Mr. Modi would really lie in taking that lesson and building up the party as an organization which regenerates itself and other leaders come up. And that's also the mark of a secure leader, psychologically secure leader. Look at Gandhiji. Under him, all these people came. He was not jealous of others. Our leaders are jealous of expertise. They are jealous of other people acquiring a base. And second point is really that the test of a system, the test of an organization is its ability to outlast its framers, its founders, or anybody who revives it. Revival would have come if the organization then outlasts when that person has gone. So everyone working on institutions, including political parties, must keep that objective in mind. Otherwise, the fate eventually is the same.
In fact, if you look at political history of India, I think one of the big mistakes our leaders have made is when they win a big election, they think that they've become invincible. When Rajiv Gandhi got the largest ever mandate in India's history in 1984, he got 415 seats. And the BJP then, Jansang, sir, got 2 seats. BJP got 2 seats, Janata Party got 10, and I think Lokdal or somebody or socialists got 3 seats. So Rajiv Gandhi boasted that for the opposition, we have declared 10 plus 2 plus 3 system. It was the first big election I covered, and I made wrong judgment. I had gone to cover the Gwalior election where Madhurao Sindhia and Vajpayee were contesting against each other. And immediately we called it Raja versus Rank, because Madhurao Sindhia was ruler of Gwalior and Vajpayee was from a very poor family. He had been educated on a scholarship given by Madhurao Sindhia's father. We went to his home in Gwalior, which had a hand pump, a buffalo. His sisters were working there as they would do in a very, very low middle class Indian family in a small town. And we thought there's no way Vajpayee was going to lose to Sindhia. And I got it completely wrong. I think Sindhia won by more than a lakh of votes. In fact, the only journalist who got it right was Tavleen Singh, and I've acknowledged that in the introduction of my book. She got it right. But the fact is that Rajiv then started thinking that he had become invincible, that he had won the next 3 elections as well. And that's a mistake people make, because a landslide lasts only as long as your first mistake, as your first big mistake, which in Rajiv Gandhi's case was the overturning of the Shah Bano judgment. You know, some of you may be familiar with it. Supreme Court had taken a liberal interpretation of personal law to allow alimony to a Muslim woman who had been divorced. Maulanas protested that this was against the Sharia. Rajiv Gandhi weighed in with the Maulanas and amended the law. It was the most illiberal thing that an Indian leader has done, that too with a majority. And then Arif Muhammad Khan from his own cabinet protested as a liberal Muslim. And from then it was just downhill for Rajiv Gandhi. So Modi will make his first mistake soon enough at some point.
Actually, that's a very important point. Faiz sahab ki ek bahut achhi line hai, ki pal bhar ko amar, pal bhar mein dhua. A thing that makes a moment eternal, and in a moment it becomes smoke. Every leader must remember that. And in fact, Shekhar, you are very right, that the greater the expectations which have swept a person to office, the more time he thinks he has. In fact, it is the opposite. The greater the expectations which have brought you to office, the shorter the time that you have in which you must deliver. At least the earnest effort must be visible, because then the people are patient. And people don't remember these things. You know, in December 1971, just to supplement what you were saying, in December 1971, Pakistan is broken. And Mrs. Gandhi is, as Atalji said, Durga.
Durga.
And in March 1973, I think I have the month right, she makes a mistake of, to control prices, she nationalizes the wholesale trade in wheat.
And then she rolls back.
Rolled back, and her decline began. And within a few months, the Nav Nirman movement started. And by June 1975, she could not stay in office except by imposing an emergency. In the case of Rajiv Gandhi, when the, Shekhar will remember that when we started this Bofors business, I remember a press conference in which Rajiv Gandhi was asked, but what do you say about the opposition? They say your government is corrupt. He said, there is no opposition. There is only one newspaper. We were the one newspaper at that time. Hindu was also not taking it up. Actually, it was the other way around. So, or kaise cheez gayi? So everybody must remember that actually people need not wait for the first mistake. Discourse can start changing even earlier if the people do not see visible action and see only announcements. So very necessary.
And when people feel let down, then they punish you even more strongly. Chandrasekhar said to you, log thappad nahi marte, jhapad marte, they give you a big blow. I remember a Pakistani taxi driver once said to me, ke Allah Mia ki lathi jab chalti hai, to awaaz bahut zor se aati hai. I mean, his context was different. I said, aap kis liye keh rahe hain? To usne kaha, dekhiye ke Indira Gandhi aur Bhutto ne aur Mujibur Rahman ne milke Pakistan ko tod ke Bangladesh banaya. Tino, hum tino ko gaddar mante hain. To tino apne logon ke haath se hi mare gaye. Indira Gandhi ko uske sikhon ne mara. Bhutto ko uske fauji ne mara, Mujibur Rahman ko uske faujiyon ne mara. So that is those are systems where you get retribution when there is no democracy. But in a democracy, people get their retribution in a very different way. If you look at the Congress party, Rajiv Gandhi got 415 into 1984. The highest number Congress has got in a normal election after that is 206. That's less than a half of that. That is 2009, and everybody hailed it as a big victory. So popularity, commitment, loyalty, even shakal, Rajiv Gandhi was very good looking, very sincere. All that doesn't last, because once people reject you, once people feel that you let them down, after that there is no coming back.
There's a very good phrase of the Buddha. Of course, that is about improving ourselves and attending to our own minds and so on. But he says, it applies to all of us, including to persons in public life, that you must act with the urgency of a man whose hair are on fire. With that urgency.
I think we can start taking some questions from the audience. 15 minutes. Sir, you in front first. If you would be brief and ask a question, not opinion.
So, or we can repeat your question. Aap
batlaye. Aap boliye, we'll repeat it. Yes, yes, yes.
Sir, actually, the question is whether it is time for a second constituent assembly to look at the constitution as a whole. There have been two views on this regard. Generally speaking, for instance, Mr. Modi's view is that we do not require and we should not attempt any great changes in the system. And he points to his own example that in Gujarat, through the same system, I delivered. That is one view. In my small view, actually speaking, India has transited to a quasi-presidential system. You look at any state government today, in no state does any state legislature matter at all. In fact, there is not a single state in which the cabinet of the state matters at all. Only the chief minister matters. So it's a presidential form. Now, in a sense, that quasi-presidential system has been installed in Delhi for the central government. So in a book of mine called The Parliamentary System, what we have made of it and what we can make of it, I have suggested 4 or 5 simple changes which would actually formalize this transition. But it is probably better, given the current circumstances and given the fact that if you open this box, then you may really be creating a lot of demands and so on, that we should let the evolution take place. But some things will have to be formalized. For instance, it is the case that we are not able, this electoral system is not able to throw up persons of sufficient talent who can help you govern the country better after you win the election. So there should be a provision by which the Prime Minister of India can induct persons from outside legislatures, persons who have proven their competence in something. I'll give you an example. You want today infrastructure projects to go ahead fast. Well, why not Mr. Sridharan? You want scientific policy to be improved. Well, why not the man who actually turned around the CSIR in Dr. Mashelkar? But if you have them, and if you have ministers above them who really don't understand that particular subject, and secretaries who don't understand the subject either. Yesterday we were being told that the secretary for health or farmers
health
is actually a literature man. So of course in that case the minister happens to be a very good doctor who understands health. But otherwise
she carries no excess baggage of degrees.
So therefore, you know, you cannot, therefore these small changes should be brought about.
Sir, but I'll add one thing to this. At least now time has come, it's been almost 4 decades since the emergency, that amendments made during the emergency. See, most people in Congress party also don't remember, Congress MPs don't remember, that the word socialist and secular in our constitution, in the preamble, was inserted by an illegitimate parliament in its 6th year during the emergency.
Yes.
When Mrs. Gandhi had delayed elections. And if you go back to the debates of Constituent Assembly, it's so beautiful how many people have demanded this, but it has been demolished, including by Ambedkar. And Ambedkar actually says something very interesting. Ambedkar says, look, this is a republic. People decide the kind of system they want to have. Today, everybody wants to be socialist and secular. But how do we know what will tomorrow's generations want? So we cannot ordain something for generations to come. But a parliament which was totally illegitimate, opposition was in jail, it was in 6th year, passed these. And I tell you, sir, the socialists would create problems for you because some nutcase judge someday will say, oh, the constitution is socialist, so that wind up all the private sector.
Right,
actually, and we've seen some judgments like that now, including the judgment in your case in that privatization,
yes, yes.
The Rajendra Babu judgment.
Ah, bilkul. No doubt on that. In fact, the rhetoric is even is gone further by one of the most distinguished Justice Kapadia, Chief Justices we have had. It is not just equality, but it is something he invented called egalitarian equality, right, which must override everything else. In one of his cases that I have analyzed in this book called Falling Over Backwards, you will see the rhetoric is such that it wipes out the notion of the basic structure of the constitution itself, which is the one dike which has protected India. But the remedy to that is scrutiny of judges, the scrutiny of judgments, which we don't do in India, unfortunately. But on your point about secularism and socialism being inserted into the constitution, it was done only because Mrs. Gandhi was trying to legitimize her assumption of power.
Yes.
And one of the things that went at that time, which no Indian political party or politician has had the courage to oppose today or ask for the restoration, is that property, which used to be a fundamental right, was removed from the Article of Fundamental Rights, and it is not therefore encroachment by the state on whatever you have built or by judges is now legitimate because it's not a fundamental right. So you are right on that.
Sir, I have
and some of the worst laws, the anti-reform laws in India that exist today were passed during the emergency. Now go ahead, please.
Sir, I have two questions. One is regarding Article 370. Article 370. Because what I think personally at this time, even Article 370 is like just become a mental status for the people of Kashmir, because to the extent it has been diluted. But still, why we are not going ahead with and repealing it? Because it's one of the big stoppers for the Indian government to start developmental work and a lot of other things. And my second question is regarding too much media interference in everything, whether it comes to judiciary and a lot of things. For example, what we saw in cases of Sony Studi or Kesatin Vinayak Sen, where media, with the help of these certain NGOs or with certain activists, they went to so extent to, you know, interfering with our judiciary. So do you not think we need a strong mechanism or machinery to even control the certain activities of media? Because sometimes they do deviate.
Sir, on the question of Article 370, I've dealt with it in great detail. The point is to delegitimize it in discourse, but do not try to repeal it just now. It is an unnecessary controversy. Usme ek Pandit ji ne cheez kahi thi, I'll tell you how it was inserted. But also, I'll tell you what Pandit ji at that time said. He said, don't worry, ye ghiste ghiste ghis jayegi. Aur actually, hota raha hai. That at that time, the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court did not extend there, of the CAG did not extend there, of the Election Commission did not extend there. Now, actually, the Kashmiris want that to extend. So that process should be allowed to go on. The point really is that, actually speaking, all we need is good governance in Kashmir, not removal or this, that, or the other at this time of Article 370. But it is an important point which you raise. That, you see, in the, how was it introduced? I don't know how many of you remember. Panditji came to a private agreement with Sheikh Abdullah and Mirza Afzal Beg that this would be the clause that will be introduced into the constitution. And Panditji had already taken away the Kashmir portfolio from Sardar Patel and given it to Gopal Swami Iyengar. Panditji told him this has to be introduced, but introduce it after I leave India for the Commonwealth Prime Minister's conference. So when he tabled it in the Constituent Assembly, the Congress people shouted and screamed and opposed it. And there was a revolt on the floor of the Constituent Assembly. So Sardar Patel called this Gopal Swami Iyengar, how did this come in? So he says, sir, the Prime Minister directed me to do this. He has come to an agreement with Sheikh Abdullah and Mr. Afzal Beg. And so Sardar Patel, he then called all the persons who had opposed it to his actually Maulana Sahab's house. Maulana was probably the president of the Congress at that time. Maulana Azad tried to explain things, but he was shouted down. Then Sardar Patel said, if I had known of this, I would never have allowed it. But now the Prime Minister is abroad. He is representing our country. So now we must pass it. That is how it was passed. And soon thereafter, as you know, Sardar Patel died. Shekhar, in the obituary reference to Sardar Patel that Panditji gives, he says, people blame me for Article 370. I was not even in the country when this was introduced. Sardar Patel is the person. And V. Shankar, who was at that time the secretary to Sardar Patel, goes to this Gopal Swami Iyengar. Hey, you know what happened? How has the Prime Minister said this? So Iyengar tells him that, actually speaking, it is completely wrong and it is unfair, and I have protested to the Prime Minister. This V. Shankar has given in his autobiography of the years with Sardar. So this was the illegitimate birth of Article 370. But now that it is there, please focus on not creating another controversy at this time, but focus on ensuring better governance in Kashmir. And the wavering policies in Delhi of anybody, you know, subcontracting in the Northeast as well as in Kashmir, that you make somebody the Chief Minister, Pakshi Ghulam Mohammed, anybody, and let him do anything so long as he keeps the pretense of government going on. That should stop.
In fact, sir, Article 370, while it's been diluted, has also been put to innovative use by smart governments in India. For example, some of the states in the Northeast which wanted special rights, those have been inserted in new sub-clauses under Article 370.
Nagaland.
Nagaland, before they signed the peace accord with the government of India, they said that Our last departing British deputy commissioner told us that there is a lot of oil under our soil and Indians will come and take it. So now there is a sub-clause, I think it's Article 370.1.2 or something, or 371 point something, which says that Government of India cannot explore for minerals under Nagaland soil without taking the permission of the people of Nagaland. And how is the permission sought? It is sought through a resolution of Nagaland Assembly. And that has been sought in many cases, it's being done. So it's been diluted, it's been used innovatively, it's not such a big problem. I think we have to stop now. I've got somebody warning me. There's only one question on Twitter, sir, if you could answer quickly. I know.
On the media, on the influence, it said the best thing, actually media should be doing more. Not by this, what is that, media trials, or sort of shouting and screaming about a particular case and then forgetting about it, but actually of scrutinizing judgments. Then you keep the judges on their toes.
Scrutinizing judgments, scrutinizing CAG reports, scrutinizing
absolutely.
Statements of politicians, because right now we just run with one, something that suits us and don't read. We don't want to be confused with facts. That is the problem. And for that, you don't need any controls or anything. You just need better journalists and better
and
editors.
Better readers.
And better readers.
Vigilant readers.
So, sir, one question from Harsh on Twitter. Aap answer kare. Do you think FDI is the right strategy to move India's growth trajectory forward?
As was said yesterday, Shekhar, please focus on the Indian investor first. And then make those very facilities available to the foreign investor. It's the Indian investment which declined under UPA 2. And certainly in the case of foreign investment, focus on foreign direct investment which will create factories, not on FII investment which comes and goes with the breeze. So there's the focus is different, I think. Too much emphasis on just making things for
on MOUs, actually.
Yes.
MOUs.
And Swaminathan Iyer has pointed to a report which shows that in these MOUs that are signed, the actual implementation rate has been 1 to high of 13%, that is all. That's 1% to 13%.
So thank you very much, Arun. We could have carried on. Next time we'll ask for a half day, 3 full sessions. Thank you very much. You've been a wonderful audience.
Thank you, sir, for the wonderful session. Since this edition is dedicated to the memory of late Dr. U.R. Anantamurthy, do visit a photo exhibition on him in the cafeteria. I would now request the panelists to please sign on the BLF wall. Those who wish to get their book signed, kindly please proceed towards the signing area. Inquisition, the BLF book quiz by Nexus Consulting, is from 3 p.m. to 5 p.m. Those who wish to participate are most welcome. Thank you.